And we're back on a, it's Wednesday, isn't it? Boy, this week is zipping along. Yes, it is the 16th day of May, as I indicated earlier. And that theme indicates it's time for Doctor on the Line. And gosh, we're blessed this morning. We have two doctors. We have Dr. Rambarran and Dr. Sparman, two well-known individuals. Dr. Sparman is not doctoring, he's authoring these days. I don't know how you find the time to do that. And Dr. Rambarran, I noticed that you gentlemen, you two, like we have been coordinating your outfits. How did that work out?
Pink, that's the way to go, always. And I didn't talk to her about anything.
No, he didn't. Wow.
That's incredible. Well, let me pose this first question to both of you. As doctors, what is the most common complaint or common issue that you deal with, medical issue?
I think that most days, there are two of them, headaches and chest pain.
Headaches?
Very, very common. Yeah. You share the same view, right?
Definitely. That's what I'm
mm-hmm. Headaches and chest pain.
And why do you think that's so common?
Stressful world. Stress. Everybody's stressed out. The world is stressed.
But some people suggest that stress is self-induced.
Well, some of it. Most things are multifactorial. Mm-hmm. But the world really is not stressful, you know. The people.
People are stressful. Yeah. If you ignore people, you'd be all right.
And it's hard to do, because you have to interact. But if you sit down and think about every problem you have, mm-hmm. you can, the etiology normally comes from somebody. Mm-hmm. Think about it, mostly. Oh.
Okay.
I like that.
Let me just let our viewers know that you can weigh in under the discussion this morning. And stress and headaches, that's what we're going to be talking about. The numbers again to call, 228-5562, 228-5563. And you can ask these doctors about anything at all.
Well, I actually want to find out how I can de-stress. One of my things for de-stressing is a good book. A really, really good book. I don't
get
into
it. Segue if I ever heard one.
That was well said. And there are other things.
Yes.
But we could start off with this. You see, you guys read this book or you didn't read this book?
No, I haven't.
1.58
seconds. I got switched first.
You got switched
on first.
See, you came on late. You came on the train late. But it's okay.
Yes.
You'll enjoy the ride. You know, basically, love, medicine. When you think about people, you think about loving, right? And then mm-hmm. think about romance, and then you think about health. They're all together. You can imagine this world here, and you just, love is removed from everybody else. We have chaos. So everything, and people, you become doctors, or you become lawyers, or you become sculptors, or whatever, and you feel that that's all. No, first you have to be a human being first. Then you can be anything else after. So everybody experienced what everybody experienced. So it's all interwoven to this fabric of society. So 1.58 seconds is a beautiful book. It came out 2010. And it's really about this protagonist, which is me, of course, but it's fiction. And but actually, what's good about the writing of this book is that I built fiction around some truth. So the reader wants to know what is truth to what is fiction. Well, you know, every fiction, there's always a little bit of truth in it. Most times a guy writes a song or write a book. It has to be something that's going on in him that he writes about.
Something emotive.
And yeah, and he expresses himself and so forth. So this came out in 2010. It's about this wonderful, this doctor who's saving this guy. And he had, for the blood to get, as a matter of fact, if you die or if your heart stops, if you, 4 minutes, you can't resuscitate that heart. Your brain, you have irreversible brain death. Mm-hmm. So what this book was about is about Johnny coming in and getting fixed up, and then suddenly his heart stopped, and this doctor had to go in there and try to fix him up. And it took, out of 4 minutes, 3 minutes, 58 seconds, or 58.42 seconds, if you do the math, mm-hmm. it's 1.48 seconds, 58 seconds. If he had gone past that, he would have had brain death. But apart from that, the doctor experienced this wonderful lady that came by, and she came with a bouquet of flowers to him. That's the end of the book. So you knew it had to continue. And that's how Switch came in. It's a hardcover, and then there's a soft.
You're an incurable romantic. That's what it sounds like. Dr. Rambarran, have you read the book?
I did.
Now, listen. Don't mind Alfred Sparman sitting next to you. You be candid. What do you think?
Honestly, I loved it. It was too short. That was my complaint. I am not kidding you. Dr. Sparman had given out advanced copies. Mm-hmm. So I read it before it went on sale. And I was like, Dr. Sparman, this book is too short. You need to do another one. So he was like, yeah, I'm going to continue it. So the next one looks thicker, and I can't wait to read that one.
But she did it in how many hours? Was it 5-6 hours? She's a fast reader.
I read it like 3 hours or something like that.
It's a little book. Listen, we have someone who wants to wait on the discussion. Good morning, Diane. Diana?
Hello?
We seem to have lost Diana.
Maybe okay. She's...
Oh, good morning, Diana. We can't hear you. Hello? All right, do we have another caller? Okay.
What I found incredibly interesting about this book was the fact that it is romance, it is love, it is pain. By the way, love is pain. It does consist of all of these emotions. But I particularly got inspired at the beginning because the doctor himself seems to be modest on emotions. But he actually opens up with the first chapter, speaking of this lady who actually greets him in the hallway and she throws his arms around him as a display of affection that he's not necessarily accustomed to. But invariably, this woman, Rosa, by the way, changes his entire mentality towards love, towards desire, towards everything.
And then not only that, you never judge a book by its cover. There's always something in there. Rosa turned out to be somebody else. So it's interesting. Good read.
Wonderful.
Do you find that romance in medicine?
Let's just say, well, a lot of doctors tend to get married to each other. So, I mean, maybe the close quarters fosters romance.
But you know what? I was having a discussion with these gentlemen. They call themselves the St. George Collective, and they meet at a certain establishment, talk about a lot of issues. Mm-hmm. And they were saying that, boy, they love to go to the doctor. And, you know, and I was teasing Dr. Tanny, who was here last week, and the guys were saying they like to go to Dr. Tanny because she makes them take their clothes off. I said, wow, you know what I mean?
That's funny. That's really funny.
But listen, wait. Good morning, Sally. How are you?
Good morning, Doc.
Morning.
Morning.
Recently, my son was diagnosed with a prolapse valve of the heart. Can you say what is the cause of it and what is the treatment?
Okay, morning, Sally. Basically, mitral valve collapse is an entity where as a matter of fact, 5% of the population, 5-10% would have that. So you're born with it. And some people don't have any symptoms whatsoever. And some people would have chest pain, shortness of breath, anxiety. They'll have some of those are none. So most it's an arrhythmia. You feel your heart beating when you shouldn't. Most of it is not really lethal, but it becomes like a fly buzzing around you. So it's the valve, instead of closing this way, it does that inwards. And this syndrome of all these things I mentioned before are associated with that. And a lot of times it happens with very slim or slender people. You come to the doctor, you get an echocardiogram. The only problem we have with this mitral valve collapse is if it leaks, then it could get the heart a little larger. So you get a checkup with your doctor every year and so forth. But people can normally have normal lifespan with that, so it's not a big deal.
We're talking about affairs of the heart with Dr. Rambarran and Alfred Sparman. We're going to take a break here and come back with more Mornin Barbados, so stay with us. And we're back on Mornin Barbados. Let's go straight to the phone lines. Good morning, Diana.
Good morning.
Hey, what is on your mind this morning?
Well, what's on my mind, I suffer from headache. I have headache like 2-3 times a week. Basically, hello?
Yeah, go ahead. Don't listen to your television. Listen to the telephone, please.
Okay. I suffer from migraine like 2-3 times a week. I drink so much painkillers that I'm allergic to most of them. The only thing I could take, it's Panadol. So I wanted to know what is my problem, and sometimes I get like things replayed in my head and I can't stop it. So if the doctor could help me, that'll be good.
She's got children.
Yeah. Morning, Diane. Yeah, that headache. You know, I had a few patients, well, that came in to me and said they don't know what a headache is, and I don't understand that. How could you not have a headache? Everybody has headaches, right? So, but some people don't. But basically, it's your arteries in that migraine that you're talking about. Arteries within the brain had a spastic or have some instability, and a lot of times because of, you know, the brain itself is a closed space. You have the scalp there. If your pressure is regulated in a certain way, and it can cause headaches because you have nerve endings there, right? A lot of nerve cells. So, but migraine itself, a lot of it can be controlled with your diet is everything. I always talk about diet. You guys hear me talking about what you eat will determine who you are. It's really true. So cheese and all those things, caffeine, those things can even exacerbate the symptoms of migraine. So you stay away from a lot of those products.
But Dr.
Stay
Rambarran,
close to the plant.
Mm-hmm. Is there a cure, though, for migraine?
No.
So you're stuck with it for life?
It's all about control, as he said, and avoiding precipitating factors.
Okay,
so.
All right, let's go back to the phone lines. Good morning.
Hello?
Yes, you're on.
Good morning.
Elroy, go ahead.
I have a problem. I'm like a vegetarian. I eat a lot of, I don't eat meat, but I eat any kind of food, ice cream. But I do not, my body do not store food. Like, I don't gain weight, and I can eat any kind of time, any already night, day, anything, I eat, as much as four people could eat. And yet I don't gain a weight, no size, no that. So I'm beginning to worry
about that. You should be thankful,
Elroy. Give me like a baha or anything like overeating. I know I really do eat overeat sometimes. Cause
good metabolism. What?
Very lucky fellow. Very
yes.
Lucky. But you know, I have to caution you though. You have a very high metabolism,
yeah.
Very high, and it's switched on and ain't coming off. A lot of people like that, but more of us are not like that. And but you got to be careful with all the eating you're eating because it's not showing on the outside, but inside you're messing things up. You'll clog up some arteries and stuff, the ice cream and all that stuff, even though you're vegetarian. And I applaud you because I am one too. I always say keep close to the plant, and it's important to. You think you have a food product? Think about plant product, and if it's got fiber in it, it'll do good for you. But yes, you know, you just have a high metabolism, but still be cautious what you eat. I know you might want to put on weight and so forth. Exercise sometimes helps you to build some muscles and so forth. So
weight training.
Incorporate it.
Like. If yeah. I can add to Elroy, you just might want to make sure that your thyroid function is normal, because a high, or what we call hyperthyroidism, can cause an increase metabolic rate. So you should just get that checked out also.
All right, we have another call on the line. Good morning, Lisa.
Hey, good morning. I just wanted to say good morning to everyone there, but I wanted to say to Dr. Sparman, you've changed my concept of how I view doctors. I usually have this idea of the doctors are so, I think, far removed. They're so clinical in how they deal with persons, but you've kind of changed my whole concept from the way how you
How so?
Been listening to. Because I think you're very open. I think that you've written your books and you're talking, you know, and I think you're so free in how you speak and, you know, what you say. And I feel as if I can really just sit and relate to you. So I wanted to say, you know, thanks for that, because I usually don't really trust doctors for some reason. So you've really kind of changed it, and congratulations on your books, and I'm definitely going to purchase one or both of them, and especially Switched. It looks really interesting and intriguing, so thanks very much for that.
Lisa, thank you for weighing in.
Thank you, Lisa, thank you.
With that in mind, though, let me ask you, is bedside manner important?
Oh, extremely important. You talk about it, Dr. Rambarran.
Oh, no, definitely. Definitely. I've seen Dr. Sparman interact with his patients at bedside, and I think that is one of the main reasons they come back to him. They love Dr. Sparman, and bedside manner is maybe 80% of it, because it's how you interact. I mean, every doctor has, you know, the clinical acumen, but it's how you interact with the person, your personality. So,
It's the human element, isn't
yeah,
it?
But,
exactly.
Yeah. Well, if you think about even me, I have to see the doctor too. You go and you sit down there.
How do you determine which doctor you go to? Do you say, well, this fellow is a good good internist, a good nephrologist, or he talks real frankly to me?
Well, not really. I mean, you check out a few things and so forth. You want to see specialists, you want to see the best. What a GP, you want to see a guy whom people consider relatively well. Mm-hmm. And I tell you, like, for instance, I was at Jacksonville, and this doctor came in to me. And it was my daughter. I took my daughter in. She had a fracture, one of her femur, actually. And instead of coming and greeting me, she went straight for the foot. She didn't shake my daughter's hand. She didn't introduce herself and so forth. And I said, Doc, stop. It doesn't work that way. I walked out. But my point is that people are nervous. You don't know what's going on with your body. You want somebody to come and touch your hand and talk to you, smile, how are you, I'm here to help you, that type of thing. Bedside manners, 80% of the work.
Wow.
All right. Unfortunately, that's where we have to leave it for this morning for a doctor on the line.
But before we go, if I may interrupt, don't forget we have the launching of this book on the 19th at Cave Shepherd. And it's at 12 to 1 o'clock. And then we go to Relish at Lime Grove on the 25th. 5 o'clock in the afternoon, 5 to 9. So guys, come and get the signature and enjoy this read.
Get
love, romance,
switched
thrillers.
Dr. Rambarran, and my good friend, always good to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing with our viewers. We're gonna take a break here, pay some bills, and come back and talk some more. Morning, Barbados. So stay with us.